Good morning, and thanks again for all of you for being here. So I know we've already talked about risk stratification, but we cannot say too often how important it is that any conversation about treatment selection start with a discussion of where your specific individual cancer is in the spectrum of risk. And as Kevin just discussed, you know, active surveillance really should be used basically universally for low-risk disease in 2024. And basically anybody with grade group one, no matter how high the volume, no matter how young the patient, family history, et cetera, the first line of treatment typically should be AS. For higher risk disease, we have focal therapy, which Hao Nguyen's gonna talk about in a minute. And then for those with higher risk disease, that's where we really talk about surgery and radiation therapy, either alone or in combination. So what is a prostatectomy? I'm gathering most of you are generally familiar with the concept here. RP, of course, means removing the entire prostate gland away from the bladder and away from the urinary sphincter, which is here. I don't know if I have a pointer on this thing. Nope. Maybe I can, there we go. This is a side view of things. So the bladder is here. The prostate sits right under the bladder and next to the urinary sphincter muscle here. And our goal is to remove the prostate with the seminal vesicles, which are the glands right next to the prostate, which with the prostate gland make the fluid that comes out surrounding sperm at time of ejaculation. In some cases, we will remove lymph nodes, depending on the risk of the cancer, at the same time as the surgery. Traditionally, this was done with an open incision underneath the belly button. Today, the vast majority of the cases here, as at most large centers of excellence, is using the Da Vinci machine surgical robot. It's called a robot-assisted laparoscopic prostatectomy. This is done through five or sometimes six small incisions across the top of the abdomen. There's a lot out there about, you know, is open better than robot or lap? You know, we hear less about this debate these days because honestly, the robot has just won in terms of market share. But at the end of the day, this is not a robot, okay? The term is actually not used properly. You know, robot implies autonomy, and I keep waiting for version 8 of the robot where I can push start and go get my coffee. We do not yet have that machine. What this actually is a virtual reality system, okay? We sit 2 feet away from the patient and drive a machine that replicates the surgeon's movements inside the body through these very small incisions with these wristed instruments that actually have more planes of motion than the human wrist. But all it's doing is translating what we do to motion inside. It doesn't do a single thing by itself. It makes no decisions and has zero autonomy yet. And as much as, you know, AI and ChatGPT are coming for pathology, radiology, primary care, I think we got a couple decades in surgery, maybe. Although not forever. So this is a surgical procedure. It does require general anesthesia. This comes up from time to time. We cannot do this under local. You can't watch the surgery. If you're interested, you can Google this and watch, you know, example cases that many surgeons have posted. The short-term risks are very low. The risk of transfusion is typically less than 1% with this surgery. And that is one of the major differences with robot versus the older open surgery is the degree of bleeding is much, much less just because of the fact of the laparoscopy. Just we fill up the belly with carbon dioxide gas during the surgery, and that pressure of the gas shuts down the most of the venous bleeding that we would typically encounter with an open surgery. Risk of infection is minimal. We give you an antibiotic for that. It's a one night in the hospital stay. We are actually gearing up this year to start doing this as an outpatient surgery that's being done at more and more institutions around the country. Depends on how long your drive is to get here is probably the biggest factor. But the point is there's really not that much pain. Men are on their feet the day of the surgery, up down the halls the next day. And it's typically a fairly straightforward recovery in general. You wear a catheter for one week, a little tube coming out the end of the penis that drains the urine you wear on a leg bag for 1 week. And we generally have you laying low for about 4 to 6 weeks, but there's no bed rest. The sooner you're up and moving, getting your strength back, the better. You don't want to pop a hernia through one of the incisions, so nothing strenuous, but lots of walking and getting your strength back as early as possible. So why choose a prostatectomy? Why would you want to do surgery? Well, first of all, it is the only way to get the final ground truth on the grade and the stage of the cancer. As much as we're getting better at targeting the tumor with MRI guidance these days, anytime we do a biopsy, we are sampling the cancer. And there is still significant rates of undersampling, underappreciating the nature of the cancer based on a prostate biopsy. And the only way to figure out the final grade and stage, as well as the subtype of the cancer, the true biology, what's making it tick, is in fact to remove the prostate. It also allows us to get a sense of the whole tumor in terms of selecting which parts of the cancer to send off for genomic testing for deeper analysis, as Jonathan described earlier. It also gives us an early readout on our success. The PSA, the blood test. Now, there's a lot of questions in the chat about liquid biopsy and about these multi-cancer tests, et cetera. These are all great, but the reality is it is hard to find a biomarker in the history of oncology that is good as PSA for prostate cancer when it's used well. Lots of controversies about how it's been used for screening, but it's an unbelievably good test for finding and monitoring prostate cancer when it's used properly. And one of the best use cases for it is the fact that after surgery, it should be zero. Should go to zero within 2 months and should stay zero forever. And if your PSA is zero, you are good. We don't need to do any further testing, no imaging, et cetera. Now, if it rises, we identify recurrence very quickly, more so than after other treatments. And if the PSA does rise, we have additional treatments like radiation, which we can bring to bear to try to kill any remaining cells in the area where the prostate was. And that's a pretty straightforward path. Surgery followed by radiation is much more straightforward than radiation followed by surgery. That is possible, but much more difficult. Now, this is controversial, but whether long-term cancer-related survival is better when surgery is the first line of therapy, there are a lot of studies showing this. Not all of them do. This keeps auto-advancing here. Not all of them do. Depending on what you read, this is a controversial statement. We can come up, maybe we'll discuss it a little bit at the fireside chat here. But the fact is, for the highest risk cancers, the answer is likely all of the above: surgery, radiation, and systemic treatment. And if we are combining treatments like that, again, there's no question we want to do surgery followed by radiation rather than the other way around. Finally, and this is talked about a little less, is that a lot of men that have prostate cancer also have BPH. They also have benign growth of the prostate that causes urinary obstruction. Most men that come in with a cancer diagnosis and years of slow stream, up twice at night, it takes 5 minutes to get the job done in the bathroom, et cetera. That's not from the cancer. That's because you also have a big prostate. And when we do surgery, we do sort of address two birds with that one stone. And it's not uncommon that men that come in with a lot of obstructive symptoms actually have better urinary function 6 months down the line than they did at diagnosis. So why not choose surgery? Well, the biggest one that I think we talk about is urinary leakage or incontinence. So like I said, obstructive symptoms may get better, but the trade-off is that there is a degree of leakage because we're operating right next to that sphincter muscle that I showed on the original diagram here. And most men will have some degree of leakage. In this day and age, there are some guys that are dry when the catheter comes out. We can certainly never promise you that. We give exercises called Kegels, which helps strengthen the sphincter muscle and the pelvic floor. You can start those even before surgery, helps things come back a little bit faster. But most men are going to have some degree of leakage. It's usually a few drops when you sneeze, that sort of thing, not an open water faucet. So most men are wearing pads, kind of like women's menstrual liners. We're not usually talking diapers, even in the early days. The typical time that you need to wear the pads ranges from a couple of weeks to a few months. 2 to 3 months is fairly typical. Sometimes it's a lot less. It can be up to a year before we say this is how things are going to be. We track these outcomes very carefully here. All the surveys that we ask you guys to do, anybody that's come to our clinics, that is how we're tracking our outcomes, is patient-reported outcome surveys. So at 1 year in our practice here, over 90% of men should expect to be dry, not needing to wear the pads. Of the remainder, most of the leakage is minor, where a pad a day kind of gets you through the day. The likelihood of long-term substantial leakage past a year for men that have not had prior radiation before the surgery is very low, only about 1%. And there are things we can do to fix it. And that's a really important point to emphasize, is that if you do have long-term leakage, it can be addressed. When Ben Breyer comes in the afternoon, he's going to get a whole session on this. Nationally, we undermanage continence issues and sexual function issues after all treatments for prostate cancer, surgery and radiation therapy. If you are still leaking past a year, let somebody know because we can deal with it. Now, this is an area where the individual surgeon doing the surgery makes a huge difference. You can go to the literature and find rates of incontinence ranging from 2% to 80%, 87%. The task force, if anybody looks at the US task force, they quote this like 75% rate of long-term incontinence after surgery. It's nonsense. I mean, you can find that in the literature if you look hard enough, but it's totally unreflective of what we expect in contemporary practice. Peter led an editorial years ago. One of the first papers that came out looking at robotic outcomes, things were worse with robotic surgery compared to open surgery. That's because the paper was really focused on bother. And you need to go into this with realistic expectations. Patients in this trial that the commentary was about, in the open arm, they were kind of expecting to be leaking for a while. The robot arm, they said, well, the robot promised me I would be dry from day one. So the perception of outcomes was very different. It's not because the robot did a bad job. Okay. This is because it all depends how you ask the question and when you ask. Okay, so it's incredibly important who does the surgery, how they do it. There's a number of technical innovations which we've adopted here at UCSF over the years to try to improve urinary function outcomes. And the reality is most men do quite well in this domain today in contemporary practice. And like I said before, if things are not better by a year, we can address it. Now, erectile dysfunction, this one is much more challenging. So the nerves that drive penile erections start way up by the spine. This is kind of another side view of anatomy here. And the nerves, what I like about this diagram, it shows this is not one nerve. Some nerves in the body, it's like a rubber band. You see it, either you have injured it or not. The pelvic plexus, the cavernous nerves that go to the prostate, start way up by the spine here, run all the way along the bladder, along the tips of seminal vesicles. This is the rectum down here. They run along the prostate on the way to the penis. They actually don't have much to do with the prostate directly. In the course of getting the prostate out, though, we disturb these nerves. And they're very small. You heat them up, you stretch them, you look at them cross-eyed, they shut down. It's what we call a neuropraxic injury. And they tend to shut down actually from the point of injury forward to the penis. And then they have to recover all the way from the back of the spine again. This takes a long time. If we have not cut the nerves, they will often recover, but it takes a long time because they have to regrow all the way from the spine. Now we can typically spare at least some extent of these nerves during surgery. This is a blow up of an MRI of the prostate. This is slices across the body this way with your feet sticking out of the screen. So the belly is up, back is down, right side, left side, the rectum is here. And the nerve bundles are, so this is an example here of how close the planes are. Tumor in this case is right here. And the nerve bundles are here and here. And you know, there's about 50 little fibers on each side of the prostate in terms of where the nerves are. It's not a nerve. That's a really important point because when we talk about nerve sparing, it's not a binary phenomenon of all or none. We can dissect. If we talk about complete nerve sparing, we're trying to remove all this tissue by leaving it behind. Remove the prostate and leave all this tissue behind. So nerve sparing can be complete. It can be partial. Okay, if we're worried about the tumor margin here, we can go a little bit wider. Or if it's a really bad tumor, we can actually excise most of the nerve bundle, which we rarely have to do. So it's not typically, it's not talking about a non-nerve sparing versus nerve sparing surgery. Here, most of the time, we're talking about at least one side complete sparing and one side, usually at least partial, even if we're worried about the tumor pushing toward the edge of the prostate. And there are things we can do during the surgery to send little bits of tissue off to the pathologists called a frozen section that can help us finesse this margin and where exactly we're making the surgery. However, even with perfect nerve sparing, like I said, the nerves are very sensitive and they tend to shut down. There are some men, very uncommonly, who never lose erections. Almost everybody, even those who come into it with great function, almost everybody loses it, at least temporarily. And typically things get actually worse and worse over the first 2 months, and then you get a slow ongoing recovery. This recovery can go on for up to 2 years. And nobody ever hears it when I say that in clinic, so I always say it twice, that it can take 2 years. And often the greatest recovery is in that second year after surgery. But we don't wait that long. So if we're not seeing at least some signs of life in the first few months, we get aggressive with what we call penile rehabilitation. We put most men on Viagra or Cialis. If that's not enough, there's vacuum device, injection therapy, lots of things we can do to force the issue and get blood flowing to the penis. Long-term, we can even do a prosthetic. We can get erection function going again one way or another. It's also important to note that, like I said, with the urinary piece, sometimes men actually wind up with better function 6 months down the road than they started with. Nobody ever gets better when we do anything to the prostate than they started with. And this is just the reality. It's a tight neighborhood. Anything we do to the prostate, surgery, focal therapy, radiation, anything has a risk of affecting the nerves, affecting the blood supply to the penis. This is just the reality of it. Plus, this whole time as we go through these treatments, men are getting older and blood pressure and diabetes and all the other things that affect erection function build up too. So we get as aggressive as you want us to be in terms of getting erection function back. It's obviously variably important to different men and their relationships, and there are always options. But actually, this QR code in the corner here, we have a whole separate document on our website about specifically ED recovery options written by Stan and the patient advocates together with our men's health experts over at the Parnassus campus. Now, even if there is perfect erection recovery, there is no ejaculation ever again. You literally get a vasectomy as part of the surgery, and you can still have an orgasm, that's in the brain, still feel muscle contraction, but there's no fluid produced. It's a dry climax, and there's no fertility for that reason. For men that are interested in potential childbearing in the future, we can bank sperm ahead of time. Some men notice a slight shortening of the penis after the surgery. That's about 5%. It's usually fairly minimal and typically resolves over time as erections come back. It may be a bit of a bigger issue when the prostate's very large and we're bridging a bigger gap between the bladder and the urethra. And everything that we've been talking about here can be more substantial, certainly if the man has had prior treatment, especially prior radiation therapy, or if we need to come in with additional treatments after surgery because it was a particularly aggressive cancer. Final note here, so Howard Wynn and his lab helped develop a new targeting molecule that Peter has now led a phase one and is just wrapping up a phase two trial that is leading us into the next era of surgery, which is augmented reality. So as I said, the robot is a virtual reality system. We are now getting into augmented reality. And what this is exactly the same targeting molecule that we've been using for years now for PSMA PET imaging in a PET scanner. You can use the same molecule to send, instead of a gallium molecule to light up on a PET imager, you can attach this to a green fluorescent marker. And during the surgery, with the Da Vinci machine, we can flip on a fluorescent camera and literally see in bright green where the cancer is. And this is quite cool. So phase one has been published now by how the phase two is wrapping up. There's going to be a phase three. It boggles my mind how many barriers the FDA is throwing up about this. These two things, the green fluorescent protein and the tracer, have been given to millions of people, and so far none of them has exploded. And yet the fact that we're putting these two together, they're acting like this is the most toxic chemotherapy known to man. It's really just staggering to me. And in the meantime, for focal therapy, which I was going to talk about, as long as the machine doesn't actively kill patients, you can just use it and track your data. It's crazy how the FDA works. It's crazy. But that's the world we live in, the country we live in. So a lot of the phase ones get done in Australia, seriously, because it's so much easier there. Anyway, this is very cool, but this is version one. So this still requires, under the Da Vinci system, it still requires about 2 millimeters of cancer to light up under vision. So, in the phase two, we have had, I had one patient on here where everything looked absolutely clear. We still missed a little microscopic margin. So there is going to be a next generation of this. And actually one of them, our colleagues in radiation oncology here has pending a very large grant to really kickstart development of the next generation imager that can show truly microscopic cancer and also can light up in a second color the nerve bundles. So we will be able to flip that same switch and see literally nerves over here in green, tumor over here in blue. We dissect this way, not that way, right? And this is the future. This is an actual surgical thing of surgeons wearing the Apple Vision goggles. I don't know what they're doing here. I couldn't find that in the article. And frankly, we're not typically even scrubbed, so I don't know what they're doing. But this is not that far off. Okay, the robot is not going to do the surgery anytime soon. But we are really getting into this era where technology is going to help us do a better job understanding where the cancer is and treating it effectively, with hopefully less and less impact to quality of life. So that's it. And this QR code takes you to the overall localized prostate cancer document, which again we've been working on with the patient advocates for many years, and has a lot of information, which I encourage you to look at. That's it.